Bible reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 66, verses 10 to 14. Isaiah 66, verses 10 to 14. Rejoice ye with Jerusalem, and be glad with her, all ye that love her. Rejoice for joy with her, all ye that mourn with her, that ye may suck and be satisfied with the breasts of her consolation, that ye may milk out and be delighted with the abundance of her glory. For thus saith the Lord, Behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the Gentiles like a flowing stream. Then shall ye suck, ye shall be borne upon her sides, and be dandled upon her knees. As one whom his mother comforteth, so will I comfort you, and ye shall be comforted in Jerusalem. And when ye see this, your heart shall rejoice, and your bones shall flourish like an herb, and the hand of the Lord shall be known toward his servants, and his indignation towards his enemies. Here ends the Bible reading.
Rock of ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from the riverside which flows be of sin the double cure. Save me from my guilt and bar. Save me from my guilt and bar. Not the labor of my hands can fulfill the lost demand. Could my zeal no rest but know? Could my tears forever flow? One for sin could not atone. Thou must save and ever know. Thou must save and ever know. Nothing in my hand I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Father to the fountain fly, wash me Savior, oh I die. Wash me Savior, oh I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I sought your words and known, and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let me hide myself in thee.
Praise the Lord. Shalom Aleichem. Aleichem Shalom. Shalom Aleichem sana yaarum solla kuda maatekiringa. Hallelujah. Shalom Aleichem. Peace be upon you. A peace be unto you. John chapter 20 verse 19. Then the same day, at the evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. John 20 verse 26. And after 8 days, again the disciples were within, and Thomas was with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, Peace be unto you. Probably this is the third consecutive week where we're meditating on God's peace, shalom. Yesterday there was a peace treaty between the Syrian government and the protesters. A war ceasefire. A ceasefire. The world calls that peace. There's no war, maybe for a couple of weeks. It's a ceasefire, it's a peace. But shalom is not the absence of war. Shalom basically means completeness. It also means prosperity, health, joy, with no anxiety, with no expectation, a contentment, etc., etc. Shalom. It was a Jewish custom to greet one another with shalom upon you. Even when they meet on a Sabbath day, even today, they meet one another. Shalom Shabbat. A shalom holy day. They always, even when they part with, their farewell wordings, Haolak Shalom, go in peace. In those days we had that habit. Soma irukkeengla, patrama poyittuvaanga, God bless you. My dear brother, my dear sister, Jesus taught his disciples, when you go to your house, first greet that house. Peace be upon this house. Peace be upon the people in the house. Peace be upon everything that belongs to the house. Shalom, a completeness, a prosperity, a health. So Jesus taught his disciples to convey this peace upon the people. It's not that in his farewell address Jesus said, peace be upon you. Not a formal, customary salutation. Even in his last words, when he was talking to the disciples in the upper room, Jesus said, I give you my peace. I give you my peace. Peace shall be upon you. I give you my peace. My dear brother, my dear sister, his completeness, his joy, his happiness, his health. He gives his peace upon every one of us. His peace will be like a river. His peace will be like waves of sea. Mighty peace. Even when mountains depart, when hills are removed, he makes a covenant of peace with us. He makes a covenant of peace with us. This peace shall be upon us and upon our children. Great will be their peace. When God promises peace, that peace is upon us and upon our children. Though Jesus gives this promise, the blessing of peace, it shall not come upon everybody unless the recipient is worthy. Last week, we are meditating on the caption, peace be upon you. Upon whom? Peace be upon you. Upon whom? We saw in Luke chapter 10 verses 5 and 6. Luke chapter 10 verses 5 and 6. And into whatsoever house you enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace be there, if the Son of Peace be there, your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall turn to you again. If not, it shall turn to you again. In Matthew chapter 10 verse 13, and if the house be worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it be not worthy, let your peace return to you. So it's all the question whether an open tumbler is worthy to receive that juice or not, that apple juice or not. If the tumbler is upside down, you pour any amount of apple juice, not a drop will go in. If the tumbler is fallen down, the apple juice will not stand in. If there is any leak, the juice will stand for some time, it will leak out. If there is any poison or toxin, that will spoil the whole juice that we cannot use it. So this tumbler must be worthy to receive that juice. It can't be upside down. It can't be fallen down. Similarly, we should be worthy to receive His blessings, especially His peace. We should be sons of peace and daughters of peace. If we love peace, and if we are the cause of peace for the others, and if we make peace with others, peace with God, peace with neighbors, peace within ourselves, then God's peace will surely dwell in us. Peace within us, peace around us. We'll be dwelling in peaceable habitation. We'll be dwelling in peaceable habitation. Within our walls, in our house, there will be great peace. Upon whom, last week we were able to see four sons of peace. Number one, we read from Psalm 29 verse 11 and a few more verses. To His people, the Lord will give strength unto His people. The Lord will bless His people with peace. We should be His people to enjoy His peace. Number two, Psalm 85. Psalm 85 verse 8, to His saints, those who are separated for the Lord, set apart and sanctified unto, for the Lord's purpose, for the Lord's cause. If your life is set apart for the Lord, you are called a saint, you are called holy unto the Lord. If our life is holy unto the Lord, His peace shall be great in our lives. So number one, we should be His people. Number two, we should be His saints. Number three, last week we meditated, to them that love the law. To them that love the law. If you love the law, your peace shall be great. That God's principle. If the Lord says forgive somebody, forgive somebody. Forgive that person. If the Lord says go and reconcile with that person, go and reconcile with that person. If the Bible says don't lie, don't lie. Just apply Bible principles in your life. Observe the Lord's day, observe the Lord's day. Whatever the Lord's principles. A few days back, a very dear brother, a very loving brother, phoned me that he should meet me very urgently. I was away and I would be coming very late. I said that we could meet tomorrow. But I could see the urgency that he wanted to meet me. I was physically too tired to talk to him. Too tired to talk to him. But when I could see that urgency in him, I said, okay, come. Come after 9 o'clock. That's the time that I'd be reaching home. He came, broken, shattered. He openly said, He would have taken some decision if he could not meet me in that night. There was no peace. He was shattered. But one thing, a very loving person, but he never tries to apply God's principles in his life. He loves God. He is a child of God. But God's principles, whether it's the Lord's Day, or paying the tithe, or assembling of the saints, it's one thing to love God. It's another thing to meticulously applying God's principles in our life. Then your peace shall be great, because the spirit world is governed by God's principles. How the physical world is governed by a lot of physical principles, chemical principles. You sow the seed, you put one seed. One mango seed or one rice, you sow it, it will bring forth 30, 60, 90, 100. If you don't sow it, Jesus said, it will stand alone, it will remain alone, unless it dies. So sowing and reaping, it's a principle. It's a principle. I don't want to sow, but I want to reap. It doesn't work out. So what you sow, you reap. You sow time, you get time. You sow money, you get money. You sow love, you get love. What you sow, you reap. You sow according to flesh, you reap corruption. You sow according to spirit, you reap life, life eternal. Because spirit is mortal, corrupt. You sow into flesh, it will corrupt. You sow into spirit, spirit is eternal. You will reap life eternal. It's a divine principle. If the Lord says, go and reconcile with somebody, reconcile with that person. My dear brother, my dear sister, about that dear brother, I can say 1, 2, 3, 4, they're all he breaks his law, breaks the laws of God. Breaks the law of God. Many a time we want to have the way that we like. We want to have marriage in the way that we want. We get unequally yoked together with an unbeliever. We break a law. We don't want God's will to be done in our lives. We want God to do what we like. We break a law. We break God's principle. My dear brother, my dear sister, we are unable to enjoy God's peace in our lives. Apply without sparing God's principles in your life. Your peace shall be great. Number 4, to have an upright life. In your talk with your husband, with your wife, with your parents, with your parents-in-law, with your daughter-in-law, son-in-law, with your family, with your neighbors, in your work spot. Be upright. Your peace shall be great. As long as our dealings are not upright, our relationship with our wives must be upright. There's nothing to hide, nothing to cheat. In the presence of God, with all humility, in a candid way I can say, there's nothing that we want to hide between us. Upright. Upright. My dear brother, my dear sister, our peace shall be great. Our peace shall be great when we are upright before God. When we are moving with others. An upright life. Let our heart be upright. Our peace will be great. I got 10 points to share with you today. We are moving to point number 5. Number 1, to his people. Number 2, to his saints. Number 3, the saints who love his law. Number 4, to the upright. Number 5. We read in Psalm 72 verse 7. In his days shall the righteous flourish, and abundance of peace so long as the moon endureth. In his days shall the righteous flourish, and abundance of peace so long as the moon endureth. God's peace is to his righteous one. There is a nuanced difference between somebody upright and somebody righteous. The difference are very definite and very nuanced. His people may be saints, may not be saints. His people, not separated from the world, are separated from the world. His people are taken into captivity because they are not holy. Then saints, separated from the world, whether they love the law or not, it's a question. There are people, those who love the Lord, but their life may not be upright. Nermai. But there is a major difference between nermai and needy. Upright and righteous. What is righteousness biblically? The English word righteousness is almost self-explanatory. You are right standing with. Righteousness is right standing with. When you got right standing with God, that is counted to your righteousness. Righteousness not based on some moral values. In these days, there is a video clipping talking about Rahab. And even one of our believers has posted that video clipping and said, you must watch it. I don't know whether she's for that content or she's against that content, but she has encouraged the group people, you must watch it, I don't know. In that video clipping, there was many major mistakes. Number one, Rahab was described as a sex trader, sex worker, or sex trader, or a word that you could understand, a prostitute, a vilay madhi. That shows the poor knowledge of that man's Bible, his very poor Bible knowledge. She was not a sex worker, as it is translated in Tamil. Rahab was an innkeeper. An innkeeper may be a sex worker, may need not be a sex worker. With all due respect, we can think that she is not a sex worker, but it's not a question whether she is a sex worker or not. But that man, because of his poor knowledge, he described her as a sex worker, or because for his convenience sake, to justify a type of a prostitution, he has said she was a sex worker. That's mistake number one. Mistake number two, these Hebrew scouts went there for prostitution. It's absolute nonsense. That shows a third degree mind of somebody to accept that passage. They went to stay in an inn. Somebody goes to stay in an inn run by a woman, If a man, a preacher, a pastor could think that he was going there to practice prostitution, that shows an ill mind of that person. That clipping is going viral in the WhatsApp. It's rubbish, it's nonsense, it's a third-rate interpretation. Somebody going to stay in a hotel. There was a humor, generally here in Tamil Nadu, especially the village side, even city, we don't make much difference between hotel and restaurant. Hotel is a place to stay, and it may have a restaurant in it, a lodge. Hotel is generally a lodge. A restaurant is a place where we eat. So a preacher from Chennai went to Malaysia. In Malaysia, when they say hotel, it's a place to stay. When they say restaurant, it's a place to eat. One of our preachers from Chennai went to Malaysia and said, so when I now the prasangam and the sahodarika romba aashirvaadama irundhuchu koota mudinjavana and the sahodari vandha enna sandhitha and the raatri enna hotel ku koottu ponnaanga. The whole congregation was upset. That pastor was personally telling me, what nonsense these people talk. I said, it's not, no, our people misunderstood. And the sister raatri enna hotel ku koottu ponnaanga. My dear brother, my dear sister, almost equal like that. These scouts, these Hebrew scouts, went to stay in or hide themselves in an inn. In an inn. When they went to hide themselves in an inn, the innkeeper, Rahab, received them. Whenever a stranger comes to an inn, even today if you go to stay in a hotel, they ask for your ID, the purpose for your visit. Those who have stayed in good hotels, just slip your hand up. Those who have stayed in good hotels, yes, they ask for your ID. You have to fill in the purpose you have come. So she might ask them, who are you? Why are you coming to this inn? What is the purpose you are visiting our nation? She must have made an inquiry. It's a very common sense. Even in those days, the intelligence bureau was very powerful. Within a few minutes, the news reached the king's palace. It's very comical. In this 20th century, in this New Testament period, 21st century, with all intelligence agencies, in the parliament, our home minister was to apologize because he got a wrong intelligence information. I don't know what was that intelligence failure. But nearly 3,000 years ago, Jericho had a very good intelligence wing. Just two men came in. Immediately, they got an information. There are scouts who have sneaked in. Scouts have sneaked in. Spies have sneaked in. Not only they got the information, they got the information that two of them are staying in the hotel. In this big hotel. Or in this inn. That inn was closer to the walls. The outskirts. The very walls of Jericho. I don't know, somebody preaches even without reading the Bible. Rahab was a prostitute. They came into Jericho, went into prostitution. Rubbish. Nonsense. What was an intelligence information that went to the king? He was sending people immediately to that place. Now, two things happen there. Number one, she is at risk giving asylum to these spies. She is at risk. She has to hide them. And somehow she believed that God will hand over this wicked Jericho into the hands of these Hebrew men. She had a revelation. She believed that could happen. We may call her, whether it is patriotism or against the nation, betrayal of the nation, sedition, treason. I don't know what the word. Vinod is thinking what word we can use for what Rahab did. You don't call her a prostitute. You may say it's a treason. It's anti-patriotism. She believed. She knew the wickedness in Jericho. She didn't know the scriptures. But she believed it could happen. It would happen. She believed it. That is the major reason she was hiding them. A day Jericho will fall to the sword of these Hebrews. When the whole Jericho would fall to the sword of these Hebrews, the seven things she believed, I don't have time, that will be a separate message. She believed that she could have mercy on this in the sight of these Hebrew people. She believed it. Is not only to her, she believed that their whole family could find mercy in the sight of this Hebrew God. So that Canaanite woman, or that woman of Jericho, that innkeeper, owner of a hotel, a one who was running that hotel, she believed it. She believed what God could do. It was counted unto her righteousness. What a nonsense it is to say her prostitution was counted to righteousness. Rubbish. What was counted to righteousness? She believed that God could hand over Jericho to this Hebrew people. This Hebrew people would be able to take over Jericho. You say it was a treason on her side? Maybe good. Maybe right. But she believed. She believed what God was going to do. Had it was revealed to the king, she and her family would be hanged for treason, hiding the spies. My dear brother, my dear sister, when we believe what God believes, when we take a stand with God, whether others could accept or not, that is counted for our righteousness. Some of you might have seen that evil video clipping. That evil, ill video clipping. That a sin was counted to righteousness. Jesus died on the cross. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ, we are made righteous. Even in that count, Jesus didn't die for Rahab then. Then she could not have been made righteous from her sin. It is not the righteousness from the moral wrongs. Jesus didn't die then. My dear brother, my dear sister, I encourage you, if you see any wrong clipping, without giving an explanation of what is right, don't spread it. Others may not know why you are posting it. Others may not know why you are posting it. At least you must give a wording. Be careful about these erroneous teachings or something. In our voice of truth, when the pastors, servants of God assemble, we show those type of wrong teachings and we explain why it's wrong. We explain why it's wrong. It was very rude, shocking yesterday when I saw in one of our believers put that video clipping and said, "You must watch." It sounded as if you keep something rubbish on a plate, a human excretion on a plate, and said, "You must eat." We have to be very careful what you post, what you share. So what is righteousness? Why was counted to be righteous in the sight of Rahab, for Rahab? It's not because of her moral grounds. I don't say anyway she is immoral. There's nothing to suggest she was immoral. But her righteousness is not based on moral grounds. What was right for God was right for her. What was right for God was right for her. My dear brother, my dear sister, Abraham took a stand that was not God's stand. When 75 he received a promise that God would give him a child. And 85 it was not fulfilled. He went to Hagar. Ishmael was born. He earlier thought his manager could be his successor. Now through his handmaid he has got Ishmael. He thought that Ishmael is her. When 99 the Lord told him, he could not believe it. So it was God's stand. I'll give you a child through Sarah. This was God's stand. I'll give a child through Sarah. And it was the stand of Abraham. Now let Ishmael live. God's stand. I'll give a child through Sarah. It's Abraham's stand. Let Ishmael live. Their stands are not the same. Let me repeat it. It was God's stand. It was God's stand. I'll give you a child through Sarah. It is Abraham's stand. Let Ishmael live. If I put it in today's language, Lord, don't be kidding. Don't be kidding. Don't go on and say, I'll give a son through Sarah. Sarah was a barren. Now even her womanhood stopped. And I lost my potency. Don't be kidding. Let Ishmael live. No, I'll give a child through Sarah. No, let Ishmael live. I'll give a child through Sarah. Let Ishmael live. Their stands are different. It was the grace of God. We don't know how it worked out. It was the grace of God that Abraham believed, hoped against hope, that God can give me a child through Sarah. Sarah was laughing. Sarah's stand was different. I cannot bear a child to Abraham. I am old. I was barren. I lost my womanhood. I cannot bear a child through Abraham. That was Sarah's stand. God's stand. No, Sarah, you will bear a child for Abraham. Somehow Sarah believed. Many times we think that Abraham believed. Nothing would happen just because Abraham believed. You read the book of Hebrews. Sarah believed. So it was the work of Abraham and Sarah. It's not just the work of Abraham. It's not just the work of Sarah. Both of them believed. When they believed, what God believed, that counted unto their righteousness. That counted unto their righteousness. What is right for God, when that is right for you, you are righteous. You are righteous. Submitting to the perfect will of God is a righteousness. See, I am a child of God, number one. I may be separated for the Lord's purpose, number two. I am holy, saint. I may love the Lord, number three. I may be upright, I am not lying. I am very straightforward to my wife, to my children, to the church, to the believers. I don't lie. Yes is yes, no is no. Number four, to be righteous, these four are not enough. I must have a right standing with God. I must have a right standing with God. What do I mean by a right standing with God? I am a child of God. I am holy unto the Lord. I love the word of God. I am upright. But what is right standing with God? Say, God wants a person, a believer, a very upright person. He loves the law of God. So he wants to marry a believer. He wants to marry a believer. He can marry any believer. But that may not be the righteousness. He must make the right choice. Marrying a believer, because he may love the word of God, he doesn't want to be equally yoked together an unbeliever. But that's not righteousness. That is not righteousness. You may love the law, yet you may not be righteous. In the Old Testament days, even the days of Jesus Christ, some of you might have read that beautiful novel, The Rogue. Anybody has read that novel, The Rogue? No one here? You're very good people. You're not as bad as your pastors. So in that novel, The Rogue, it came as a picture also. The Roman soldiers, a battalion was coming into Jerusalem just to give an extra bandobast during the Feast of Passover. So in that Mahamaham, a large number of policemen are engaged there, sent from different districts. Like that, during the Passover, every time they expect some trouble, so some soldiers, some battalion was coming from Rome. When these battalions are coming from Rome, that's how the story developed. They saw some old clothes, some chapels strewn everywhere. So the Roman officer was asking, why these chapels and these old clothes, vessels are thrown at every place? So somebody was explaining, these Jews were very law-abiding people. According to their law, the seventh day was a Sabbath for them. They don't do any work on that day. They don't go to any place they want to. How is it possible? They don't go anywhere? No, they got an interpretation, a distance call, the distance of Sabbath, Vohivinal Duram, about 2,000 cubits. Only about 2,000 cubits they can go on a Sabbath. From where 2,000 cubits? Oh, they got their funny interpretation. They can go 2,000 cubits from where? From their possession. What do you mean? From their house, from their possession. But these law-abiding Jews always misinterpret their laws. So what they do on the previous day, they'll send their slaves with all old chapels, with old clothes, with broken vessels. They'll walk 2,000 cubits. They'll leave one chapel. And that slave will walk another 2,000 cubits, leave another old chapel. He will walk another 2,000 cubits, leave one old clothes. Walk another 2,000 cubits, leave one shawl. So Saturday, this Yajaman, from his house he can walk 2,000 cubits. That's the distance he could walk on a Sabbath. There his whole chapel is there. From there he can walk another 2,000 cubits. From there he can walk another 2,000 cubits. He can go where he wants to go without breaking the law. That's the absolute way they were following law. That is why Paul was able to say, we didn't break any law. So you may be a child of God, you may be separated from others, you may be very upright, you may love the law, but you are not taking a right standing with God. You are a child of God, you are baptized, you are anointed, you want to do the ministry, but you are scared to go as a missionary. You want to have a pastoral ministry. Just say, we can have a regular income. We have got a small group that could support us. You want to do the ministry, but you are not righteous. What do you mean by righteousness? What is right with God is right with you. God wants you to be a missionary, you be a missionary. God wants you to be an evangelist, you are an evangelist. God wants you to be a pastor, you are a pastor. If I am not a pastor, I don't take a right stand with God. In the presence of God, I tell you, I never wanted to be a pastor. When I could see the gift of operations in me, healing the sick, leading the people in receiving the Holy Spirit, prophesying, preaching the word of God, I never thought that I would become a pastor. I preferred to be an evangelist. Not to preach to the same congregation week after week, morning and evening. I never wanted to be a pastor. But what is righteousness? When you take a right standing with God, your peace will be very great. When you take a right standing with God, why don't you have peace? Why the peace is not like a rolling waters upon you? Why the peace is not like a rolling river upon you, a roaring waves? Why? It's all because you didn't take a right stand. In your marriage, you don't take a right stand. Oh, they belong to our caste. They're good, they got their own house. She has got a good job. She is good looking. So many constraints. But what happened? You don't have peace. You don't have peace. I may be a child of God, I may love the word of God. It's not that I marry a believer. It's a question, I marry a person God has chosen for me. That's righteousness. I'm doing a ministry that God has chosen for me. That's righteousness. Taking a right standing with God. This righteousness comes to us because of the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross of Calvary. Because of our faith in Him, we are made righteous. We are made righteous. My dear brother, my dear sister, somebody marries a person. Not for the sake of color. Not for the sake of cost. One servant of God said, he is a preacher. He told me, personally told me, ஒரு பொண்ணு திரு கல்யாணம் கட்டினா ஏபிசி பார்த்தா போதாது, ஏ டு செட் பார்க்கணும்னார். I got surprised. What is A to Z? ஏ டு செட் பார்த்து கட்டணும் பிரதர்னர். He was elder to me at that time. Even now, he is elder to me. I asked him, Anna, what is A to Z? Age, beauty, cost, dowry, education, fairness. He went and I have forgotten. Non-stop he said up to Z. What are the A, B, C, D we should see? My dear brother, my dear sister, that's not righteousness. Only one thing. Is it God's choice for me? Have I taken a right stand with God? Even the whole world is against me. My relatives are against me. My friends are against me. Even I may be against me. But I am taking a stand with God. That is righteousness. My dear brother, my dear sister, then your peace shall be great. Your peace shall be great to the righteous. Number 6. Psalm 37 verse 11. Psalm 37 verse 11. But the meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. The Lord is against the proud, the arrogant, the meek. The meek is the strongest person. He's not a coward. Because somebody has got a meek disposition doesn't mean he is coward. He is Yesu Shanta Sarubiyava. Shanta Sarubiyava. So what is this meekness? It's not to be inactive. The Bible says Moses was meek. But we see Moses as a very strong person, very brave person. Even he commanded to cut the heads of the people. What is literal meekness? One thing is gentleness. Law abiding, not law enforcing. Helping others to abide by law. To be meek, to be gentle, you need these three qualities. Number one, you should be law-abiding. Number two, you should not enforce law on others, even when they break the law. Number three, you should help them. You should help them keep the law. I give a very simple illustration. How this peace will be abundance in your house. Then peace shall be abundance in your house. Jesus promises, there shall be peace within your walls. Peace in your palace. Just imagine a simple situation. You have got a rule in your house that when you switch on the light, when there is no use, switch off the light. Am I right? Do you agree with me? Those who agree with me, just wave your hands. Let me see how many of you agree with me. Okay, it's a good law. When you want, switch on the light. When you don't want it, switch off the light. So what is law abiding? Whenever you want the light, you switch on the light. Whenever you don't want, you switch off the light. Now what is the second quality? One is law abiding. Number two, you should not enforce it. Your husband has forgotten to switch off the light. You go and hang. No, light put anakaliya. Peace irukuma. Your wife has forgotten to switch off the light. Electric bill evlo aagudhu? Peace irukuma? Small example. You are law abiding. Good. You are enforcing law. Ama idhula dhaan periya chala vandhuchu. Neenga chalavalikkiliya? Neenga veenaakkiliya? அப்புறம் உங்கள் அம்மா, உங்கள் அப்பா, உங்கள் வீடு, உன் வீடு. ஆமாம், நீ ரொம்ப ரொக்கம். Why? Why is there no peace in your house? Why is there no peace within your walls? Okay, you don't law abide. You don't switch off the light. When somebody points it out that you have broken the law, you will not accept. Oh, what's the big thing in it? Are you not doing it? So finally, both will take a decision. What decision? I should not blame you. You should not blame me. Let the electric bill be 6,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees. You don't blame me. I don't blame me. You. There will be a type of peace. What is that peace? Absence of what? Absence of what? You don't blame me. I don't blame me. You help your child. You talk to your child without nagging, without irritating. not when they have made mistake. By showing an example, help the person accept that law or abide by that law. These three steps will bring peace. These are the qualities of meekness. You abide by law. When somebody doesn't abide by law, don't get irritated. Help that somebody to abide by law. Boy, it's very difficult. That's meekness. That's gentleness. That is shantam. In a literal meaning, shantam is not being quiet. Shantam is not having your lips zipped. Shantam is much more than that. Shantam is much more than that. What is shantam? What is meekness? When some wrong is done, not getting irritated over that, not condoning that. I can put it like that. When there is something wrong, not condemning the person, not condoning the wrong. Don't condemn the person. Don't condone that wrong. What is condone? Don't say it's okay. Don't say it's okay. That woman was found in prostitution. She was brought to Jesus. Jesus didn't condemn her, but he didn't condone adultery. He said, go, no more sin. Go, no more sin. He was gentle. He was not getting irritated. He was not angry over that sin. But he didn't gloss over that sin. He didn't say, it's okay. It's okay, there's nothing wrong in it. No. He didn't condemn that person. He didn't condone. Condone, condemnation means, how can I put it in Tamil? Condemnation. Okay, okay, we'll overcome. We will overlook it. This law, we will overlook it. You must have this many days of attendance. Okay, you got a doctor's certificate, you are unable to attend. Okay, we'll condone it. We'll condone that law. We give a condemnation. Okay, you can write the exam. Glossing over the law. My dear brother, my dear sister, if your peace is to be great, if your peace is to be abundant, if your peace is to be like a roaring river, you must have a meek personality. If husband and wife are meek, 100% there will be peace within the walls, peace in their palace. The peace will be abundance. If the parents and children, they got this meek disposition. Shantam. Shantam is not being mum, not back answering alone is shantam. Whenever you think about shantam, meekness, gentleness, shantam, dayavu, almost the same. The basic principle for meekness, not getting irritated, not getting angered over moral lapses. Nevertheless, being angry against the immorality, against adultery, not against the person who has committed adultery. Showing love and compassion to that person. My dear brother, my dear sister, number 7, just I read that for you. Romans 8:6, the spiritually minded. To be carnally minded is death. In Romans 8:6 says, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Life and peace. What is carnally minded? What is spiritually minded? We'll continue next week. Shall we pray? You must have this peace that passeth all understanding. Surely you would be able to enjoy peace in your life. if you are a child of God, and if you have your life separated unto the Lord, set apart for His cause, and sanctify unto that noble purpose, and if you love the law of God and apply God's law in your principles, and if you are upright in your dealings with others before God, and whenever you take a right standing with God, what is right for God is right for you. When you have got a right standing with God, and number six, when you are meek, you are law abiding and not law enforcing, and also help others to abide by law, your peace will be great. When you are not meek, there can be no peace within your walls. You abide by law and you force law on others. You condemn others for their lapses. There will be no peace in your house. There will be no peace in your family. Take a solemn resolution. I am going to be meek with my husband. Even whenever there are small lapses, he may not keep the things in proper places. He may throw his socks somewhere. He may leave the coffee cup without cleaning it or something. Small lapses. He may come late. He might not have phoned you. He might have answered your phone. Don't get irritated. There will be no peace in your house. Similarly with your wife. For all her lapses, don't get irritated. Don't act as if you are very good, too smart. There will be no peace within you. Children are children. Remember that we were children. Don't be angered at their lapses. Don't try to beat them because you are a bully. There will be no peace in the house. Don't act bully. Fathers are not bullies. Mothers are not bullies. The way some parents torture their children, police station is better. Even they stoop to third degree torture. You want to have peace within your walls. Peace in abundance. Be meek one before the other. Be meek one before the others. Let the chastisement of peace be upon you. You be the cause of the peace in the family. You love peace. If you love peace, God's peace shall be upon you. If you are a son of peace, if you are a daughter of peace, peace shall come upon you. Not only meek, be spiritually minded. Be spiritually minded. A shalom be upon you. For our family is to be blessed. Shall we pray? I request Sister Prami to lead us in prayer.
கட்டளையிடும்படியாய் நாங்கள் ஜெபிக்கிறோம். மட்டுமாய் எங்களுக்கு உம்முடைய வேத வசனங்களை குறித்த விளக்கங்களை கொடுத்து உம்முடைய ஆண்டவரே இந்த சமாதானத்துக்குள்ளாகவே நீர் எங்களை வைக்க சித்தம் கொண்டிருக்கபடியினால் நாங்கள் அம்மையை ஸ்தோத்திரிக்கிறோம். ஐயா இயேசுவாக எங்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையில் ஆண்டவரே உம்முடைய நீதியை நாங்கள் தரித்து கொள்ள அதிலே நடக்க கர்த்தர் உதவி செய்யும்படியாய் ஜெபிக்கிறோம். கர்த்தாவே இயேசுவை இந்த வழியிலேயும் ஆண்டவருடைய ரைச்சஸ்னஸ் ஆண்டவரே எங்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையின் குறிக்கோளாக இருக்கட்டும். ஆண்டவரே கர்த்தாவே அப்படியாய் நாங்கள் மக்களாக நடக்க உதவி செய்ய கர்த்தருடைய கரங்களிலே நாங்கள் தாழ்த்தி ஒப்பு கொடுக்கிறோம். ஆண்டவரே தொடர்ந்து கர்த்தாவே நீர்தாமே இந்த சமாதானத்தின் நிறைவை கர்த்தாவே நாங்கள் பெற்றுக்கொள்ள கர்த்தர் உதவி செய்ய முடியாது சமைக்கிறோம். எங்களுக்கு வேண்டிய மீக்னஸை தாங்க. குடும்பங்களையும் மற்ற சமுதாயத்திலையும் நாங்கள் கூடி வரும் இடங்களிலேயும் இப்படியாக மக்குன்பாக ஆண்டவரே உங்களுடைய சாந்தத்தோடு நடந்து கொள்ள வேண்டும். கர்த்தர் கிருபை தரும்படியாக ஜெபிக்கிறோம். சகலத்தையும் உங்களுடைய பரிசுத்தக்காரங்களை ஒப்பு கொடுத்து ஜெபிக்கிறோம். இயேசு கிறிஸ்துவின் நாமத்தில் கர்த்தாவே தேசாலும் ஒவ்வொருவருக்கும் உரிமையாக இயேசுவின் நாமத்தில் பிதா.
ஆமென்.